Okay, I'm going to cover memory and thinking today, but more on memory than on thinking. Okay, so let's start. Okay, how do we remember things? Well, there are three basic processes that we go through, or the brain goes through at least, when we are exposed to some kind of information. So whether or not some information gets remembered depends on the acquisition stage or the story stage, or when those information are remembered, are stored in memory, are they retrieved effectively? So these are the three basic processes. Now within these processes, there are sub-processes as well, but I won't go through them in detail. Okay? So the acquisition stage is when new information is taken in. It could be visual, it could be auditory, etc. And I will elaborate on this a bit more. And following acquisition, there's storage. Some memory gets stored in short-term memory. Some memories get stored in long-term memory. And when we want to try and recall something, that's the process of retrieval, that is searching for some item, some information in memory and finding it. So acquisition involves gaining new knowledge. Why is it some information gets remembered, some does not? And when we gain new knowledge, some of this new knowledge gets established as new memories in long-term storage. And acquiring memory isn't just copying information. It isn't like a Xerox machine or a photocopying machine. You have to have some kind of mental engagement or intellectual engagement with that material for that material to be remembered more effectively later on. And what we think about that material, so for example, this slide alone, what you think about it has an impact on how it will be stored in your memory. If you're just having a quick glance at it without really thinking about the sentences, then it's much less likely to be remembered than if you're actively trying to think about what I'm saying here. Okay, and what we think about it is what is actually stored in memory, rather than something that you're just exposed to in terms of sensory information without actually thinking about it. And how your memory is stored has implications on what memory is stored has implications on what you will remember. You will obviously only remember what is stored in memory. Okay, and it will also have an impact on what circumstances you remember it. So, for example, if you were asked to memorize some information in this classroom, are you more likely to remember the material if I ask you to recall it in the classroom or outside? Okay, the context in which you remember it. And what is stored in memory will also have an impact on how accurate your memory is. Will there be any false memories in your memory as a result of what other people say, for example? I will talk more about this later on. And how you remember things might occur through intentional learning. This is classic, a classic method in how you study for your exams. Okay, you deliberately try to memorize material from the textbook. And it's the idea of placing new information in memory when you know you anticipate that your memory will be tested later on. You know you will need this material in your head later on, so you try to remember it as well as you can. So an example would be revising for a general psychology exam. And I just realized my mic isn't even... Ooh! Okay. Now, of course, some material that you will remember from general psychology might not necessarily happen only through intentional learning. Yes, some of the material in my PowerPoints, you might deliberately try to memorize it. But some, you unintentionally learn it anyway. You, for some reason, you remember it without actually memorizing, actively trying to memorize it. And this is called incidental learning. Learning that takes place without any intention to memorize it. And it usually happens without you actually being aware that you're actually learning the material, you're actually remembering the material. So one example, apart from incidentally remembering what I taught you, is remembering what you ate for dinner last night. Now, you didn't try to memorize what you ate for dinner. You simply did not have to. But if I ask you today what you had last night, most of you, or some of you, will actually remember it, even though you did not try to memorize it. Can you give me other examples of incidental learning?
When you watch a movie?
Remember parts of the movie, even though you did not try to memorize it, but you are able to discuss the movie with your friends even 2-3 days later. Any other examples? Yes? Remember the weather yesterday, yeah? You don't try to memorize the weather each day, but yes?
Remember a dream.
Remembering a dream, yeah? Yes? Listening to song and remembering the lyrics. Okay, good. Now, another stage process, more specifically for memory, would be how the information passes through different types of storage, different types of memories. And when information first arrives, when I taught you sensory perception, sensation and perception, we know that the brain processes sensory information. Now, why is it some sensory information become sensory memory and some do not? And some of the sensory information gets selected and interpreted in short-term or working memory. It's called working memory because your brain is actively working on these pieces of information, deciding which would go into long-term memory and which would not. So long-term memory involves a further process of selection and interpretation. So sensory memory is raw sensory information, which I've taught you. So information entering the senses, triggering neural messages that are sent to the brain. And there are two types of memories, among other types. Iconic memory would refer to visual sensory information that gets remembered, that ends up in the memory trace. Echoic memory would be auditory sensory information. Now, short-term or working memory is a place in your brain where you hold a small amount of information while your brain is working on it. Okay, why is it that not all information that you're exposed to gets stored in memory? It's because your brain simply does not have the capacity to do so. So it has to select, it has to be selective. And this is the stage where the brain decides through several processes what kind of information should be stored permanently or long term. And working memory can only hold information for very short periods of time. So let me give you a short-term memory test, and you should have a paper and pen. Okay, I do need to sign in first. Okay, so you are about to do a small short-term memory test. A few letters will flash on the monitor for 3 seconds. Your job is to write down as many letters as you can remember after they disappear. All right, forget about the data test. Okay. You were supposed to write down what you just saw, you know. Hold on, let me pause this while I get rid of this annoying jumping logo. Oh, yeah. Okay. This is considered an easy one, by the way. Okay? All right. Now, I'm going to teach you a few more slides where we're talking about different effects that you might get while you're trying to remember, for example, a list of words or a list of letters. Okay? So, we'll go back. You can think about your material in a bit. Now, as opposed to short-term memory, long-term memory allows you to hold vast amounts of information for extended periods of time. So it's a more permanent storage place. So an example of the things that you might store in long-term memory would be memories of your personally experienced events, memories of your personal life. For example, you might remember what happened when you were 12 years old. These are the kinds of things that are stored in long-term memory. Now, consider what I asked you to do just now. Okay, to remember a list of letters and write them down to recall a list of letters. And it's also common for memory tests to be free recall tests where you ask an individual to list as many items in a list as the subject can recall regardless of order. So write down everything that you remember from what I just showed you. And there are two effects that could happen. The primacy effect refers to the tendency for a subject to recall the first items on a list. Okay, so the top items on a list more easily than those in the middle. The recency effect refers to the tendency for the subject to recall the last few items on the list rather than those in the middle. And why does this happen? It's because there's a limit to how many items you can think about at once. Okay, there's a limit to how many items can be maintained in your working memory. So the recency effect happens when new words entering the working memory, so the last few words entering the working memory, bumping out the words that were there a moment ago. And the last few words don't get bumped out because no new information was presented to bump them out. Okay? So those items are still in working memory. Now, well, why is it that you might remember the first few items on the list rather than the middle ones? It's because when primacy effect happens, it has to involve some form of long-term memory. That means the first few items on your list has already gone into long-term memory from working memory. The first few words presented gets more attention and rehearsal than the later ones because you go back to the beginning to try and remember the beginning more than you try to remember the end, which enables these first few items to get established in long-term memory. Well, what is the capacity of working memory then? It's about 7 items plus or minus 2 items. And a strategy for you to remember a string or a list of words or a string of letters would be to chunk them. Chunking involves reorganizing the material or information in memory so that more can be remembered. If I gave you a string of 12 letters just like that, okay, FYI USATHXBRB, it's much, much harder for you to maintain those 12 items in memory than if you chunk them into four units, FYI, USA, THX, BRB. Why might there be another reason apart from chunking for you to remember this whole string well? Yes.
Because they're like commonly or frequently used abbreviations.
Right, right. Because they also mean something to you. They're not just nonsense groups of letters. Okay. I deliberately made them in thought of three-letter groups that make sense to us. FYI, USA, THX, and BRB. So you're much more likely to remember it as these four chunks than as a 12-item string. And while you're trying to remember letters, so for example, from the memory test earlier, you might have already been chunking subconsciously. Okay. Now, as I said, for some memories to be remembered more effectively or memories to be stored in long-term memory, you have to have some kind of mental engagement, intellectual engagement, or thinking about it. Long-term memory is not automatic. It requires some form of mental engagement, and not all information we're exposed to gets established in long-term memory because we don't necessarily think about all the information we are exposed to. The more we make sense of some kind of information, the more we think about some kind of material, then the more likely this memory will be retained. So you might process some information in a shallow manner, which is called shallow processing, versus deep processing. Shallow processing would involve you looking at some information and seeing the superficial aspects of it. Now, you're much less likely to remember this kind of material if you're only processing the superficial aspects than if you're really thinking about a word or really thinking about a sentence, which requires deep processing, which would lead to better retention in memory. And this has been shown in neuroscience data, where you see greater levels of activity in the brain, especially in the hippocampus and prefrontal cortex during initial memory acquisition. And this leads to greater probabilities, okay, more likelihood that your memory is retained later on, that you are able to remember it later on. So what are the best study techniques if we want to apply it to studying for an exam or studying in school? It would be techniques that really emphasize efforts towards understanding the material. So rather than memorizing sentences after sentences in textbooks, but really thinking about the material, actually understanding what you're memorizing is more important, is more effective. So you're less likely to remember things in a textbook if you haven't understood them at all, or understood them at a very shallow level. So just repetitively memorizing things or repeating things, repeating sentences to yourself to memorize them, which are mechanical strategies, will actually be not beneficial for effective study. Okay? And people have also tried to use mnemonics to try and remember material. That is to make connections between different types of material. So these are deliberate techniques that people use to help them memorize the information. Now, some of you, I certainly remember when I was an undergraduate, I would make a lot of cue cards for myself, linking all the different types of topics or different words together to help me try and remember everything about long-term memory, for example. And so it involves connecting, linking new material to ideas already in memory. Okay, and you link various elements of the new material to each other, whichever makes sense to you. And another way to form connections is to visualize, to form mental pictures of the items that you need to remember interacting with each other. Now, the problem with mnemonics, though, is when you make connections between one group of material, you become too focused, you become too narrow, that you are not able to so-called think outside the box or remember outside the box and link new material or other unrelated material to this set of linked material. Now, after you acquire memory, as I said, some memory goes in, the information goes into working memory, some gets filtered out and goes into long-term memory, some does not. But whatever gets stored in your brain as a memory is stored in terms of a memory trace. Okay, it's a record in the nervous system that actually preserves a memory of a past experience. And memory consolidation happens when a biological process takes place after an event is experienced. And this biological event takes place for a period of time, several hours after you're exposed to a particular piece of information. And this consolidation process, what it does is it transforms memories from a transient, fragile status to something more permanent, more robust, something more concrete, something more long-term. And this time period when this biological process happens allows the creation of new patterns of communication among neurons to represent the newly acquired memory, basically for the trace to become more permanent. And why is memory consolidation significant? Well, if you think about it in terms of retrograde amnesia, then you will understand why is it that some memory gets remembered and some memories don't get remembered, okay? Because some memories become consolidated, some do not. Now, retrograde amnesia happens when a person suffers a loss of memory for events that happen just before the brain injury. Okay, you might have heard of cases where people have been in a car accident or other kinds of accidents where head injury happened, or tumors, diseases, or strokes, and they are not able to remember what just happened before. But they are able to remember events that happened several years ago or several months ago. Well, why is that? It's because the injury interfered with the consolidation process of recent memories. So whatever happened on the day of the accident or several hours before the accident did not have time to become consolidated in memory. So the person who suffers that head injury will not be able to remember what happened at that time, but is able to remember things that have already been consolidated in memory. Okay? But it still doesn't explain why people are unable to remember events that took place months or years before the injury. Okay, so why is it things that happened much longer earlier does not get remembered? So this is still being studied. This is still being understood. Okay. So we've got acquisition, and some memories go into working memory. Some information goes into working memory, some information goes into long-term memory, and you have a set of memories in your brain. Then comes the process of trying to remember it, trying to recall it. And this is a process of retrieval, okay? Retrieving information from memory, provided there is a memory trace for it. And there are two basic major processes that you can go through while trying to retrieve a particular memory or information. Recall versus recognition. Now, the recall process involves drawing information from memory in response to a cue or question. And it's a task in which some item must be produced from memory. So a typical recall question would be, tell me everything that happened yesterday. Okay? Asking you to recall everything that you remember. I don't give you any specific information to say yes to or to say no to. Or it could be in the form of an open-ended essay question, which will be in your exam next week. Okay? For example, describe long-term memory. It's not necessarily going to come out, by the way, so don't take it seriously. But that is a possible question. Describe long-term memory. Then you are required, or you are asked to, write down everything you remember about long-term memory. It's not multiple choice. Multiple choice would be tapping into your recognition memory. Okay? And recognition retrieval means that you have to judge, you have to decide whether or not you have encountered a stimulus previously, or whether or not you read this answer, or you remember this answer. So an example would be multiple choice. I give you only A, B, C, D. you have to decide which is it that you remembered. So it's completely different from recall memory or recall retrieval. Okay? Another example of recognition would be, did you wake up at 6 o'clock this morning? Okay? It's a recognition question because you're either required to say yes or no. Okay? You're trying to remember whether or not you did wake up at 6 or you did not wake up at 6. It's different from tell me everything that happened this morning. Okay? Another real-life example that I could give you based on my own work is eyewitness memory. Now, when you have witnessed a crime, let's say, okay, a whole group of you, I might ask some of you, tell me everything about the criminal. That is a recall memory question, a recall question. You will have to tap into your own memory, everything that you can possibly remember about the criminal. Now, I could also ask you a recognition question, which is something quite common, would be, was the criminal the young guy who's always standing outside the school? That would be tapping into recognition memory. You have to judge whether this criminal, it does match this young man who you always see outside the school. Okay, so you can put it this way, it's not open-ended for you to try and remember it on your own. So these are two very different types of questions, and they have two very different types of implications. Now, in terms of eyewitness memory, the research shows that recognition questions are much more risky. Because what if I ask you a question that is not in your memory? It might become false memory instead, or it becomes misleading information or misinformation. I will touch on misinformation in a bit, okay, so don't worry. Well, we do forget things, or there are certain types of information that we simply do not remember. Well, what can help memory retrieval? Retrieval cues are stimuli that helps one to recall a memory. And these are cues that needs to recreate the context in which the original learning occurred. Okay, it has to be have some kind of relationship with what you're trying to remember. So, for example, you might be able to remember your childhood more easily when you're back in your hometown, when you see the buildings that you were playing outside as a child, or seeing your old home. So these buildings, the hometown itself, is a cue. It cues your memories of your childhood. Can you give me other examples of retrieval cues? What might you see? What might you hear? Yes. Food? Elaborate? Give me a concrete example. What kind of food would cue what kind of memory?
Some memory like your family, because those food maybe were usually made from your mom.
Okay, so which is the memory? Which is the cue? The food is the cue, and it reminds you of your family. Maybe, okay. So there might be a particular food, let's say that you always eat with your mom, or your mom is always making for you. Every time you eat that food outside, you think of your mom. Any other examples of retrieval cues? Yes.
I have a scar, I can remember where it hurt.
Okay, so if you have a scar, you might remember, the scar will always remind you of that accident that you had, or that mishap, etc., or what someone did to you. Yes?
People with the same accent as me, because I'm always being the worst being an accent from a hometown, then I will remember, oh, this is your hometown, maybe from somebody.
Okay, so a particular accent would remind you of your hometown,
yes.
Yeah? Other examples? Yes?
Music, which I've heard in this certain situation, and if you hear it again, it will remind you.
Okay, so when you hear a particular song, it might remind you, I don't know, of the time someone broke up with you, or the time it was love at first sight, or something like that. What else? Yes?
Pictures.
Pictures? Okay. So seeing photos will remind you of where you were at the time, what you did at the time. Any other examples? How about in terms of words, rather than personally experienced events? What word would be a good cue for another word? This is how children learn vocabulary, right? Yes.
Yeah, words that rhyme, basically.
Words that rhyme? Okay, yeah. What else? If a child was going to learn a new set of words that are animal names, what would be a good cue? For example, for that list of names, for all the names in there. Piano wouldn't be a good cue, right? So it would be another animal word, or zoo. Zoo would be a good cue for those words that are relating to animal names. Okay? So it doesn't just apply to your personal experiences, to your daily routines, but also learning material. Okay? So it works something like, well, when I give you your multiple choice questions, let's say there's a word in there that you remember very well or that you have made an association with, then that would be a very good cue for your memory. You are able to answer that multiple choice question because the statement I gave you is a good cue for your own memories. Now, another way would be to do context reinstatement. Basically, asking you to retrieve your memories in exactly the same context where you acquired those memories. Basically, putting yourselves back in the same mental state or physical state that you were in during your initial acquisition or learning. And you can improve your ability to remember the information. So, for example, if I asked you to learn a list of words, to remember a list of words underwater or on land, this was actually a real study that was done, and I asked you to recall it, but for some of you, I asked you to, if you remembered it underwater, and I asked you to recall it underwater again, you're more likely to remember it than if I asked you to recall it on land, if you remembered it underwater. If I put it in a different, again, back to forensic psychology, sorry, that is my expertise, so I'm giving you a lot of examples. This is classic as well. So, for example, if a crime happened some time ago and you are trying to ask, let's say, a child to try and remember something, then you could ask the child, close your eyes. Okay, this will be putting yourself into the mental state. Close your eyes, try and think back to when it happened. And you give the person some time to basically transport themselves back in time to when it happened. Tell me what you smell. Tell me what you hear. Okay? Is it hot? Is it cold? Tell me what you see. And the person starts retrieving memories by trying to be in the mental state that this person was before. Or it could be physical state. So in some places, I've heard that you might take a witness back to the crime scene to interview them at the crime scene. And it might work very well. For example, if there was a robbery at a bank and you're trying to ask a witness to remember what happened, the person might be sitting in a police station and say, I can't remember. Everything happened so fast. You bring this person back to the crime scene, back to the bank where it happened, this person might be more likely to remember everything because the person is back in the context, in the physical context where it happened, where the person first acquired all this memory, this information. Okay. Now, retrieval also, or how memory is retained, how memory is retrieved, also depends on encoding specificity. Okay. Retrieval is most likely if the context at the time of recall is similar to the original encoding context, exactly extending from what I just told you, context reinstatement. Because memory trace is specific, okay, what you remember is specific. It's not just a photocopy of information that you're exposed to. It involves your feelings about it, involves your thoughts about it. So there has always been an assumption that you are more likely to remember something if it means something to you. Okay? All of us might go through exams, but why is it for some of you, maybe the exam has a bigger emotional impact, and you're more likely to remember everything that happened during the exam compared with other students who either did not care about the exam or were not going through an emotional process during the exam. And specificity has powerful effects on retrieval because the cue has to reflect the content or the context of the original stimulus. So the more similar the cue is to your own memory, the better able you are to retrieve it. The context in which you're trying to recall, the more similar it is to the context you acquired that memory, then the more likely you're going to be able to remember it as well. So let me give you an example. Something heavy will be a good cue for the word piano if you were shown the word in the context of the man lifted the piano, but not in the context of the man tuned the piano. Because giving the cue something heavy to the man tuned the piano will not really remind you of an association. The association is not meaningful to you. Okay? Whereas lifting implies that there's weight in it, and something heavy would be a good cue for that piano in that context. Now, why do we forget, or why do we recall the wrong information? According to Ebbinghaus, this is a very famous theory. I'll show you a graph in a bit. Ebbinghaus claims that memory declines with the passage of time. So as time passes, our memory declines. We forget. But the decline is uneven. We forget the most rapidly, immediately after learning, and then it becomes more gradual. It becomes more steady. So as you can see in this graph, now, bear in mind, Ebbinghaus based his theory on experiments that he did to himself. He basically tested his own memory for lists of words, etc. So this actually hasn't been tested much in larger samples, okay, and in the current era. This was quite a while ago. But this theory has been tested, has been discussed a lot. And it does happen in some cases, but some researchers say, well, it doesn't happen to memories of personal events. That people don't forget personal events that easily. It's actually these memories could be quite stable. So your memory could be affected, or some memories can be forgotten, through one of these two processes. Decay. That is, your memories decay as time passes. And this happens when normal metabolic processes wear down your memory traces until they fade and finally disintegrate. Now, this happens when you haven't rehearsed that memory, when you haven't thought about that material. Okay, so it becomes so-called neglected, and then it decays and disappears. Now, your memories could also be affected if there's new learning. That is, there's new information entering your long-term memory which interferes or disrupts information that's already stored in memory, in storage. But not all new learning disrupts your memory. Okay? If the new information is very different from what you have learned, what you have stored in memory, then that memory is less likely to be disrupted, to be interfered. So, for example, learning how to skate will not interfere with your memory of your general psychology material, okay? Because those two materials are completely dissimilar. not unrelated. It's also not, new information will also not disrupt your old memory if it's consistent with the information that you have already learned. So there's no interference when the new learning is consistent with older learned information. So for example, if you take general psychology in college, this new information will not disrupt what you learned in high school, if you learned psychology in high school, okay? Because it's an extension from, it adds to that information. It doesn't negate or disrupts that information. So it's consistent with that information. But the problem happens when there are intrusion errors, when this new learning becomes a false information. That is, intrusion errors refers to memory mistakes when someone tries to remember elements that did not actually happen. So these elements are mixed up into the person's own memory. And these intrusions are often small. So a simple mistake, and not really important mistake, would be thinking that you called your mom last night, but actually it was really 3 nights ago. Can you give me another example of an intrusion like that? Or a memory mistake like that? Can you think, I'm trying to ask you to recall, do double recall. Think about something that you made a mistake on, a memory mistake. Any, yes?
I think about writing an email too much. I think I already sent it, but I've never actually written.
Right? If you have been thinking about responding to a particular email so much, you might, and because you're rehearsing it in your head, the whole response, you might end up thinking that you have already sent that email, but you actually haven't. Any other examples? Yep.
Okay, mixing up a timeline of events, like sometimes you think you remember it's you did something first, then another thing later, but it's really the second thing you did it first.
Yep. So mixing up the sequence of events. Anything else? Now, some of these errors might be negligible, might not be very important. It doesn't have a huge impact unless you forgot to pay your bills. But there are some things can be very large errors. It has legal implications. So when you are a witness of a crime, or when someone is trying to recall abuse, or recall an event that has never happened, it does happen. Why is it that some people can talk about something that never happened, but talk about it as if the person really experienced it? And this happens because there might have been a misinformation effect. When people are presented with incorrect information or misinformation about an event they witness, this correct information is often incorporated into their original memory of an event. So how can misinformation be introduced? Well, it could be you're hearing the wrong information for some people, and you might hear it so often, you start to believe it, that it really happened to you. Okay, so let me give you an example of a research study. Some researchers wanted to test to see if children are able to remember a complete false event. So they asked children to repetitively think about an event where their finger was caught in a mousetrap. Okay, and they tested their memory later on. Now, many of these children really seriously believed that it happened to them, even though the researchers later told them, no, I just told you to imagine it, it didn't happen. But these children continue to stay true to their belief that, no, it did happen, my finger was caught in a mousetrap. Now, these are children, but adults too are able, do have the weakness of reporting a false memory. Okay? Classic cases are when some people might go see a psychiatrist or clinical psychologist. And during therapy, the person might start talking about some feelings, some problems in the family. Now, a problem happens when the psychiatrist or clinical psychologist say, well, maybe something bad happened to you. Did someone do something to you that you did not like? And if the person, the mental health professional, starts suggesting things like these, it becomes a very, very big problem. Because therapy as a therapy sessions continue, and this person starts to feed information that something might have happened, this person might actually start to believe, oh, maybe something bad really happened to me. Maybe I really was abused, and that's why I'm feeling so horrible right now. Maybe this is why I'm depressed, etc., etc. Okay? So it's unintentional, but misinformation has a drastic impact, and it could lead to false memories. False memories could lead to false accusations, etc. Intrusions can also happen without misinformation fed by another person. Intrusions can also happen because you have schemas. Now, what are schemas? Schemas are mental representations that summarizes what we know about a certain type of event or situation. Okay, so a possible schema for going to McDonald's is we enter the doors, we go to the counter, we order maybe one of the value meals, pay, and for a child, the schema always involves getting a happy meal. So this child has some kind of representation of what usually happens when you go to McDonald's. Okay? Can you give me other examples of a schema? Yes.
You go to the 7-Eleven and you always hear the one in, and then you go, I don't know, why go buy some stuff you should buy, like meal or something.
Okay, so that for you, there might be a schema for going to 7-Eleven that you absolutely have to hear Huan Yin Guan Lin, or else it doesn't become 7-Eleven. Or there's something different about that day, and you're always there to buy some form of food,
yeah.
Okay, or drink. Any other schemas? The problem with schemas, because we all of us have schemas about what usually happens in different situations or in different contexts, it becomes a problem when something different happens, but we don't remember that something that was different. Okay, because we already have this general representation of what usually happens. So we might miss details that are different for some reason on that particular day. And think about this in terms of, for example, remembering a crime. Okay, if I have a schema for going to the bank, okay, there are certain steps that I always go through, or everyone goes through. And the schema might prevent me from remembering specific details about what happened at the bank that day. Or for some people, it might not. Because those things that happen are so different from my schema, I remember them particularly well. So it could work both ways. Okay, I'm not saying schemas will mess up memories for everyone. But when we try to remember an event, we rely on a schema to make a reasonable assumption about what may have happened. Okay? And it's this process that might cause us to forget certain things or to make mistakes about our memory. Now, another example for a schema would be our schema for a professor's office would be there has to be bookshelves. Not in mine, but most professors' office, you would have bookshelves and you would have books. Again, not in mine. But if something happened in a professor's office, you might talk about your schema and miss certain details that were different. Maybe for some reason, half of the books were missing that day. So you could either remember it clearly because it was so different from your schema, or you remember your schema, or you report your schema instead, okay? Now, if you think about learning words or remembering material like letters or words or group of words or vocabulary, then there might be intrusions from semantic associations. Okay? And the Dees-Riediger-McDermott paradigm, DRM, refers to the tendency for someone to falsely recall a target word from a set list of words centered around that target word. So for example, I might give you a list of words. They're all related to sleeping, to sleep. But sleep is actually not on the list. But you may be at risk for reporting sleep, the word sleep, even though it's not on that list, because all the words on that list were related to sleep. So you make this intrusion error by reporting a word that is in meaning or semantically related to what you actually remembered. Okay, so you incorrectly remember sleep as being on the list. Okay, before I go into varieties of memory, let me give you your break. Okay? All right, let's continue because I want to show you a very special video on traumatic memory. Okay. Now, there are several types of memory, and we can group these into two major groups, explicit memory and implicit memory. And there are several types within explicit memory, the first being semantic memory. Okay? The vocabulary that we have, the words that we know, these are called semantic. These belong to semantic memory. And it's a type of explicit memory that includes knowledge of words and concepts. And the knowledge is not tied to any time or place. Okay? It doesn't have to be remembered in a particular context, or it's not related to a particular context. Unless for some reason you learned the word mouse when you were being bitten by a mouse, which would be very rare. And semantic memory is also called generic memory. So for example, what is the capital of Taiwan? A question like that would require you to tap into your semantic memory, or any other words that I'm asking you to name, to recall. Episodic memory, on the other hand, is completely different. Okay? It's a type of explicit memory which includes memory for specific events or episodes. Now, these events might not be personally experienced, personally participated in. You might have witnessed this event. You might have watched this event. But examples of events that would lead to, or that would be episodic memory, would be your 16th birthday or your 21st birthday, what you had for breakfast this morning, okay, what you learned in class yesterday, etc. And within episodic memory, we have autobiographical memory. Autobiographical memory would be what defines you, okay, your personal history. What you remember when you were a child, what you remember about your time in high school. These different types of events, different types of experiences would be remembered as autobiographical memory. Okay? Flashback memories are memories of events like September 11 or the Japan tsunami, 3/11. I'm going to talk about flashback in a bit. Memory for traumatic events as well, which I'm going to show you a video on. Now, sometimes traumatic events, okay, also depending on how traumatized a person is by an event, are not recalled until much later. Why is it some people seem to be completely blanked out when they are asked to recall a traumatic event, like a car accident, or a terrorist attack, or kidnapping, etc.? It can be explained by physical duress, simply, and you will see in the video later on why is it some people might be affected. Their memories might be affected by physical duress. Okay, I'm going to show you a video on the Beslan terrorist hostage crisis, where a few Chechenian terrorists held a whole school as hostage. And these people were not hardly slept and drank and ate for 3 days. So sleep deprivation, head injuries, alcohol abuse, these are the different kinds of physical duress that could disrupt the memory process, okay, or the consolidation process, if you like. Now, traumatic events could also be associated with extreme stress. Okay? And extreme stress associated with the event may disrupt these biological processes that I talked about needed for memory consolidation. Now, it also happens when that memory gets repressed. Okay, why is it some people definitely experience something like abuse, but for some reason cannot retrieve that memory? It's because it may have been pushed out of consciousness by defense mechanisms designed to shield a person from psychological harm. Because if the memory is repressed, this person is less likely to relive the trauma, to feel the whole stress or anxiety or fear again. Okay. So if I focus on flashback memories, considering all the different events, horrific events that have happened lately, okay, flashback memories are vivid, detailed memories. Vivid means you can see, you can have this mental imagery very clearly in your head about what happened. Okay, your memories are very vivid, are very clear, are very detailed, and these are produced by unexpected, highly distinctive, and emotionally important events. Okay, and most examples of flashback memories involve events that trigger fear to a certain extent, horror or grief. So, for example, when the Twin Towers were hit on September 11, a lot of people can recall exactly where they were, what time it was, exactly what happened, who was with them, the smells, the dust, things like that. Now, one unique characteristic of flashback memories is when people are recalling a flashback memory, they're usually very, very confident about it. I am sure I was here, here, here. I am sure my best friend was with me. Or I'm sure my best friend never left my side. However, while flashback memories are associated with strong confidence, so people who recall a flashback memory are usually very confident, they are usually not very accurate. Okay, they're often not accurate, even though they are confident about their own memory. Of course, you wouldn't expect flashback memories to be remembered so perfectly, because as I showed you earlier, there are these different processes that could disrupt the memory. So flashback memories involve stress at the time of encoding, and it could disrupt or it could enhance. Okay, it's still a debate whether or not stress during the acquisition of memory will lead to better or worse memory later on. Let me show you now a video of, I don't know how many of you would remember or know of the Beslan hostage crisis. The reason why I picked this video, first, is about a negative event, a horrific event, and also because BBC did a wonderful documentary by interviewing the children who were held hostage. So these terrorists basically held the whole school hostage. There were hundreds of children and parents in the school at the time, and hundreds of them died at the end of the three-day crisis. Okay, so this documentary is great. It gives you a bit of background, so you're not completely going into the film without background. And I want you to pay attention to what the children tell us, okay? And I would like you to tell me what you think about what they said or what they recall. Now, what is unique about this documentary is we are able to check if what the children said is true. Because it's quite rare, but for some reason they got the terrorist video. So you could actually see what happened and compare it with what the children tell you to see how accurate their traumatic memories are. Any comments or thoughts about what they told us about their memories? Do you think their memories are likely to be accurate? Yes.
I think it's a traumatic experience, so most of those kind of memories are very accurate, and you can tell them again and again and again.
Why?
Because it's something you remember for sure. It's not something you dream up or
Well, until now it's still a debate, because on one hand we would think, well, yes, because it's something that instilled so much fear in you, so much anxiety in you, that you're more likely to remember it. On the other hand, physically, because you're in so much arousal, such high arousal state, that so many biological processes are happening in your body that somehow your memory processes are disrupted by these other biological processes. So yes, it looks like for most of these children, they remember them very well. Now, what was also unique compared with a lot of other interviews that I've seen with children, like victims of abuse, these children are very introspective, meaning they talk a lot about their thoughts, about their feelings towards this. You know, I don't understand this, I don't understand this. I was thinking at the time what I wanted to do, or I was hoping at the time Harry Potter would come and save me, things like that. Any other observations you might have made? Yes.
There was one kid who was, he was very exact about the exact places where everybody was standing.
And the kid that walked around?
Yeah.
Yeah? I think that's why they chose him to be the one showing all the different aspects. Now, bear in mind, this was the first day of school. There are also children who have already, they're not newcomers to the school. So newcomers and non-newcomers, I suspect this boy is not a newcomer. So that's why he remembers the school so well, inside out, where the closets are, what this closet is for, etc. Yes, Christopher.
So they were like too sure about their memories. Kind of feels like they rehearsed it then before coming to the camera.
It's possible.
It feels like it, because that documentary was how long after the event?
I can't remember. But it's a very, very good question. I did mention this as well in another class. Some of them might have, if it's been months or years, probably not years. I think it was within a few months, because they wanted them to capture them soon. Another thing is, many of them would have gone through therapy, and they would have talked a lot about their feelings. So yes, this is probably not the first-hand account that we're hearing from them. But yeah, at least we get some kind of insight into how they were feeling or what they remember about what happened. Yes?
I think school have, I don't know, I feel it's rehearsing, because they talk about it so well that even if, when you talk about this so much, that person can be leaded into think something or feel about it some way that he didn't thought about it at first.
Yes, it could happen that some of them might be reporting information that they heard or etc. But some of these children are shown in the video to be sitting right in front of a dead person or the person who was shot. So it's extremely highly likely it's their own true memory rather than... but what you're saying is because they tell it so well. Now...
Yeah, and not the part about the memory, yes, but kind of they started talking so much about their feelings at the moment that it might as well not be the real feelings at the moment.
Why?
Because, as you say, they've been through therapy and all this stuff. They talk about it so much that that in therapy they could be led into thinking that, oh, I was thinking about this. Maybe I was thinking about
it. It is possible. I like not to be too negative about it. So I kind of keep both perspectives. Some of them, yes, they might be rehearsing, they might be repeating things that are not representative of what they actually experienced. But I would also like to believe that for the rest, it's true for them. Now, how verbal they are, how eloquent, articulate they are. Some children are just very verbal and very well articulated. I certainly heard victims of child abuse, children who have been abused, talking very fluently or very clearly about how they were feeling about the abusive event. Okay, so now you didn't see the ages, exact ages of these children, but you will see a developmental trend that as they get older, they are better able to describe their experiences, etc. Any other thoughts? Now, let's think about a horrible event that applies more to Taiwan. Okay? There are many, many children who have gone through natural disasters. Do you think that Taiwanese children's memories of natural disasters would be very similar in terms of content, in terms of accuracy, to these kinds of memories? What do you think might be different about natural disasters? Or let's focus on one, the 921 earthquake. How might the memories of that be different? Now, I know the majority of you are Taiwanese. Yes.
Maybe it's not less special because all of us express this pattern. Maybe it's not like the positive or something that only people are in.
Less special because there are more people experiencing it. Yeah. Also because you are mentally prepared, sort of. Okay, you're not mentally prepared for an earthquake to suddenly happen, but you all know that Taiwan is at risk. So you all already have, you know, you're not going to expect a hostage crisis anytime soon, but you know maybe there's a good chance for an earthquake or a typhoon to happen. So it's quite a different mentality and emotional preparation going to that kind of stuff. And this one, yes, about more than 1,000 were involved in this, a much more smaller scale than victims of a natural disaster. How else might the memories be different? Yeah.
Unlike this video, the Taiwanese children would have the chance to communicate with others, so their feeling might be affected.
Yeah, very good point. So during a natural disaster, you know, children are not restricted from talking, whereas here they were restricted from talking or else they would be killed. So while they are communicating their feelings, their experiences during a natural disaster or post-disaster, that might lead to different kinds of the different quality of memory than this kind of memory. Any other thoughts? Yes?
The trauma is different too.
How?
Because this one was caused by another human being, so you will not trust anyone that easily. You will be like with natural disasters.
Good point. So the two different, this trauma is caused by other human beings. A natural disaster, well, is up to the child to blame it on. Who knows, they might come up with another being to blame it on. But yes. Oh, I suddenly had a thought and now I lost it. Any other thoughts? Yes.
The time span is different. The natural disaster happens shortly and starts and ends shortly.
Right, okay. A natural disaster doesn't last for 3 days. Okay? How else might the memories be different? How about how the children would describe the experience? What do you think the differences might be between Taiwanese children and these Russian children? I'm not even sure if that's politically incorrect. Should I be saying Chechenian children? Or East Asian children? No one has actually really studied this in detail, how especially how Taiwanese children describe a personal experience. Do they talk the same way as I highly doubt it? Do they talk about feelings, Taiwanese children, or do they talk about facts, you know, exactly what happened? Any thoughts? Okay. So let me move on rather than showing. Let me see. Yeah. I think I can show you a bit more, just to give you a flavor. A bit more. Oh, no, hold on. I do want to go through your group ideas today. So let me carry on. Okay, so explicit memory covered things like semantic memory, episodic memory, which also includes autobiographical memory, flashback memories, memories for traumatic events, or emotional memories. Then you also have implicit memory. Implicit memory is simply the knowledge, procedural knowledge that you have acquired, knowing how to do something, like riding a bike, using chopsticks, okay, tying a shoe. And it's actually much harder for you to lose these memories than memories of a personally experienced event. And procedural memory, or this type of implicit memory, usually involves behaviors. Now, an example of an implicit-explicit memory distinction can be seen in the classic case of H.M., who was a patient with epilepsy, and he was treated surgically. So most of his hippocampus, that is involved in learning, and amygdala were removed. And it resulted in anterograde amnesia, where he couldn't form any new explicit memories. Okay, so he simply was not able to remember new events, etc. However, with this disability, he could still acquire implicit memories from specialized testing. And he could be taught how to work his way through a maze, although not the same way as others. But he would have no recollection of ever having seen the maze or learning how to work the maze. He simply just acquires this knowledge to work through the maze. Okay? So he doesn't remember the event of being exposed to the maze, but he gains this procedural knowledge, this procedural memory. Okay. I'm going to now move on from memory to thinking. All right. When we're thinking, there's some kind of presentation, some sort of presentation in our mind that allows us to think about something. You don't just have a blank sheet when you think. Okay, and these are called mental representations, which represent the content of our thought. What is it that we're thinking about? And mental representations are literally how our thoughts are represented in the mind. Okay? When I'm thinking about a cat, do I have a mental image of a cat in my head, or do I think of the word cat in my head? Or do I only think about the ears or the tail? Or do I think about any cat or just my cat? So there are many different ways that, many different mental representations that are involved in a thought. And the contents stand for some object or some event. Okay, we might think of a particular object, we might have a mental representation of a chair, a table, or we might have a mental representation of a whole party, okay, as we experienced it. And it allows us, okay, these mental representations allows us to think about these things even though they're not there. Okay, so we might have left the party, but I can continue to think about the party on the way home. Because I have this mental representation of the party. And mental representations can also stand for things that exist only in our minds. So we might not actually have seen a word or seen an image. For example, I might never have been to Hawaii, but I could have a mental representation of myself sunbathing in Hawaii. Okay? So you could have mental representations of things that you have not experienced, that you have not seen yourself, but you're able to think about it. Okay? These could be internal symbols, actions, images, or words. And different, there are different types of mental representations following from the last two slides. Analogical mental representations share some of the physical characteristics of an object and usually takes a form of mental images. You have this visual representation of it. For example, when you're trying to remember whether a person has had short hair or long hair, for example, someone you met in a party, then one will usually call to mind a mental image of that person's head. Okay? It's rare for you to think about a person's hair without having an imagery of the person's head, and you try to mentally see the hairstyle to see if you could remember whether it's short hair or long hair. Can you give me another example of an analogical mental representation? Well, another way would be when I first arrived at NTU, I got lost so many times you would hardly believe it. But I'm horrible with directions. So I would always try to have this mental image in my head of where the psychology department is and make sure I remember physically all the buildings surrounding it. Okay? So for me to try and remember the location of one, I would create this mental image, or I would subconsciously have this mental image in my head of, I always see something red first, and it's tall, and then I turn. I'm not even sure if I'm correct. But I'm just saying that you would mentally, mapping is one classic way of using mental imagery to find something, or to think about something, or to remember something. Any other examples? Anything related to food? Let's say, I like to cook, and I had something really delicious in a restaurant, and I'm trying to recreate it at home. Okay, the whole thing. For me to remember exactly what ingredients were in that salad, for example, I might try to have a mental imagery of that salad when it first arrived at my table. I remember, okay, there was something orangey, so it must be carrot. And then there's something, some black pieces on top. What was it? But I basically keep reliving this mental imagery of that dish to try and remember what was in it and think about how I should cook it, recreate it. I've given you three examples. Surely you can give me one. How about when you're trying to study for exam? How might you have an analogical mental representation? Yes. And you remember that whole chart or whole connection. Okay, so you think you have a mental image of that whole thing,
yes.
Yeah? Or remembering a graph, okay? It's very possible for you to remember some parts of the physical aspects of the graph and then trying to think about the graph a bit more, trying to fill in the blanks. Okay? You might also have symbolic mental representations, and these mental representations do not necessarily correspond to the physical characteristics of that which it represents. So for example, the word mouse does not resemble the small rodent it represents. You might think of the word mouse differently as opposed to thinking about the picture of a mouse. Okay? The word itself does not necessarily correspond, does not look like a mouse, the word itself, compared with. So as I said, sometimes when we think about something, we have mental images, sometimes we don't. And our mental images are like pictures. We have kind of photo shots in our brain. And when we think about something, when I think about a place, a food, that imagery immediately comes to mind. And neuroimaging studies do show that many of these same brain structures are active during both visual perception and visual imagery. So when you're having a mental image in your mind, even though you're not actually seeing it, you're not actually getting that sensory information, your sensory areas are activated. So it's pretty remarkable that mental imagery also activates sensory areas in the brain, primarily in the occipital lobe. And a classic study of mental imagery involves asking participants to memorize the map of a fictitious island and form a mental image of it. Okay, so this is the exact map that they ask subjects to memorize. So if I ask you to memorize this now, it's a fake, fictitious island, and I want you to form a mental image of it. And then I ask you to imagine a black speck traveling from one location to the other. Now, because you're actually seeing this, I should have created an animation to take it out and ask you to imagine. So let me play that again, since it's cute. I really like doing this, by the way. And what they found, remarkably, was that the time needed for this speck, for people to imagine this black dot moving, was directly proportional to the distance between the two points on the original map. So even if you're trying to move the dot in your head without seeing this imagery at all, how long you take to move this dot is proportional to how far the two spots are from each other. Let me give you another example of mental imagery. Okay, the duck rabbit study. Okay, so I want you to look at this picture. What do you see it as? Some of you see it as a duck, some of you see it as rabbit. Okay. Bring that mental image to your head again, what I just showed you, okay? Have that in your head. I want you to try and change it, reinterpret it as a rabbit if it's a duck for you. If it's a rabbit for you, try and spin that mental imagery and see it as a duck. It's very difficult. If you originally saw it as a duck, and I don't show you the picture, I ask you to reinterpret your mental image. It's very, very difficult, sometimes almost impossible for you to reinterpret it as something different, okay? Because the corresponding mental image, what you see, rabbit or duck, is already organized in your head, and it's interpreted to some extent already. So it's very hard for you to change that. Okay. Moving on for mental imagery, there are four types of directed thinking: judgment, reasoning, decision-making, and problem-solving. These are very big areas, so I'm only going to touch on them briefly, not go through them in detail. Judgment involves drawing conclusions from experience. Okay? And various steps are used to reach beyond the evidence encountered so far. So judgment involves some extrapolation. Okay? And some element of risk that the extrapolation will be mistaken. An example, we conclude that we like all movies with Tom Cruise because we have liked all the movies we have seen him in it. But this judgment might be a mistake because we might come across a movie with him in it that we may not like. We just don't know when. Okay, so this is one example. Can you give me another example? Anyone? Yes?
I say that I like to eat watermelon, but maybe I I buy a watermelon, but it is a kind of wild perfume and badly taste, and then I have an experience that I
okay, so you might conclude, you might make a judgment that you like any watermelon, but because you have liked all the watermelons that you have eaten, but then you might come across a watermelon that's for some reason gives you a very bad experience, either it was bad or it tasted horrible, and this judgment becomes a mistake. Okay, this conclusion becomes a mistake because you did not take into account further experience you might have that might change this judgment. Another example.
In the past, some people used to think that all swans are white, but actually they are black swans.
Okay, so making a judgment that all swans are white until you see otherwise. Yep. Okay, so you might come to a conclusion, judge this professor to be very bad, until you have a much later experience with this person where that judgment changes and because the experience has changed. Okay. And judgments, many judgments are made using heuristics. It's basically a rule of thumb, some kind of strategy that describes how humans solve particular problems. Okay, for you to solve a problem, you have to make a judgment, make a decision later on, which I'm going to teach. So heuristics are strategies that help us make judgments more quickly, but at the price of occasional mistakes. One such heuristic is the availability heuristic. It's the rule of thumb often used to assess how often I have experienced something, how often I have seen something, encountered a particular event or object. And when examples of events come easily to mind, we conclude that circumstance is a common one. Okay? So for example, buying a watermelon. If I consider all the times I bought watermelons, they taste good, then my conclusion would be that, well, what's the chance that I'm going to get a bad watermelon? But there are errors as well. Very vivid events will be easily remembered but may also be rare. And the availability heuristic can be a problem if you start generalizing because it becomes problematic when they involve friendships. Okay, when you generalize that, oh, anyone you meet is going to be your friend, but that judgment becomes wrong when a person decides not to become your friend or your current friend decides to break up with you. Availability heuristic also becomes a problem for money decisions and work-related decisions. The other heuristic is the representativeness heuristic. Okay? It's a rule of thumb or strategy by which we estimate the probability an object or event belongs to a certain category based on how similar, how prototypical it is of that category. And this strategy assumes that each member of that category is representative of that category. So we know what to expect next time. And errors happen when we generalize the result of a single case to other cases or situations. in relation to judgment or decision making, it's reasoning. Okay? And we always try to reason before we make a decision, or reason about a decision after it has been made. Reasoning involves drawing implications from our beliefs. If I believe in X, what other claims follow from this? And deduction involves deriving new assertions from premises, assertions that are already in place. So if premise A is that engineers are good at math, premise B is Tao is an engineer, then C, based on that reasoning, C, Tao is good at math. Give me another set of premises. But let's not have a war between departments here. Someone, give me another example. Yeah.
Models are beautiful, and marriage is a model. So I'm thinking that marriage is beautiful.
Okay. Models are beautiful. Mary is a model. Mary is beautiful. Other examples? Taiwanese love food. You are Taiwanese. You must love food. What else? Even an elementary school kid could come up with a set of premises, I'm sure. Come on, give me one more. Yeah.
It is warm in the sun. The sun shines outside. It is warm outside.
It's warm in the sun. There is sun. So it's warm outside. Yeah? Anything else pertaining to a person, perhaps? Judging about a person or an object? Yeah? Okay, fair enough. Germans like beer. You are German, and therefore you like beer, and do you? Okay. Now, of course, it becomes a problem if we go backwards, that because you generalize all Germans, okay, every time you meet a German, oh, you must like beer. Then when you meet a German who does not like beer, your judgment becomes a mistake. Okay? So that's a classic problem with representativeness heuristic. Well, why is reasoning important? It allows us to use our knowledge in new ways. For example, we know that if it's raining, today's barbecue will be cancelled. We see that it is raining, so we can reason that the barbecue will be cancelled. So you don't necessarily go all the way there and see nothing, certainly no food. And it provides a means of testing our beliefs. So for example, you reason that if someone likes you, he or she will say yes with enthusiasm if you ask them out. You can test that theory and find out if the person likes you. Okay, so you have a reasoning to believe this, and if that what you experience does not fit that, then you already have a judgment based on that reasoning. Now, of course, there's a problem with confirmation bias as well during reasoning. That is the tendency to seek or endorse evidence to support my own belief, and ignore or dismiss evidence that will challenge our beliefs. Okay, and this is classic in gamblers. Okay, compulsive gambling, a person will remember very well all the wins. Okay, and believe strongly in the chances of winning, which bolsters, which increases the belief that one can win again, because I have been winning. I have been winning, and I have not lost. But the person remembers losses as near wins or as bad luck. Okay, so this person has this bias towards a particular reasoning. Oh, that I'm just losing because I'm having bad luck. Or I really was almost winning. It wasn't really a loss. Okay. Now, in terms of decision making, one of the major theories is utility theory. Okay, it's the idea that one should always consider the possible outcomes of a decision and choose the most desirable one. And the attractiveness of the outcome would lead someone to choose the option with the greatest benefit and the least cost, okay, in all the kinds of decisions that you make. And the likelihood of achieving that outcome would lead you to choose the option that gives the greatest likelihood of achieving the things that you value. So you make a decision based on how attractive the outcome might be, okay, and we all have a bias for more positive outcomes or reducing negative outcomes. And also, we make decisions based on what are the chances that I'm going to achieve what I want to achieve. Okay? Now, how a question is phrased or how options are given will also influence our decision making. Okay? It affects the subjective desirability of an event by changing the standard of reference. So, for example, comparing all outcomes to the worst possible result, 50% failure rate, versus comparing them to the best possible result, 50% success rate. Now, finally, problem solving involves the thinking that we do when we know what our goal is. Okay, but we need to find the steps, we need to find the means, we need to find the strategies, what we need to do for us to reach that goal or at least start moving towards that goal. And the means and analysis refers to the strategy in which we keep evaluating where we are from our aim, towards our goal, and the resources that we have to help us achieve that goal. Okay? So a common question we would ask during the means and analysis is, what is the difference between my current state and my goal? What means do I have? What resources can I use for me to reduce this distance between my current state and goal? So, an example, I want to get to class. What is the difference between my current state and my goal? Distance. My bed and Beiguan, Erling Liu. What means do I have available for reducing this difference? My bike, even though I might not use my bike, especially if it's raining, etc. Okay? So this is a very simple example of a means and analysis. Solving a problem, you need to get to class by thinking about the difference between your current state and your goal and reducing that distance. Now, means and analysis, that was a very simple problem. But if it's a bigger problem, one can also replace the initial problem with a series of sub-problems. So you break down your goals into mini-goals. Okay? For example, I need to get to class with a full stomach, okay? Because you can't pay attention in class if you're hungry. So I have a sub-goal. I need to pick up some food on the way to class. So you break down your goals into going to class, getting food, and you reduce the distance on both. And try to come up with the best way of getting to class the fastest by reducing the distance as much as you can, getting the food, and from getting the food to getting to class. Okay, so it's possible to break your goals into sub-goals and breaking them into smaller problems that will be easier to solve. Now, a common phenomena in decision, in problem solving is automaticity. Basically, you're automatically doing to do something without paying attention to it. Okay, it becomes automatic. Another way of thinking about this is executive functioning, okay, another concept related to this. Now, automaticity in reading in adults can be seen in a Stroop task, which I would like you to do on the next slide. Okay, how many of you have done the Stroop task? Oh, good. Now, you have to name the color that the word is printed in. You are not naming the word. You name the color the word is printed in as fast as possible. Okay, ready? Go. Yeah, that's very fast.
Red, yellow, orange,
I realize you start slowing down. No. Or you go like blue, eh? No, green, eh? Red, no, green. So it happens because you start, it becomes automatic and it's very hard for you to change back. So it's quite natural. I also did this test in my undergraduate, your reading speed becomes much, much slower as you reach the end of the list. How about if I give you this one for those who read Chinese? Go. That is not fast. The color the word is printed in, not the word. Okay. Yeah, I think you can't see the colors as well as on my computer. Okay. So basically, the effect that you see, the Stroop effect, is a marked decrease, a very significant decrease in the speed of naming colors. The skill of reading becomes automatic, so you can't help but read the word red rather than the color the word red is printed in. Okay? And so there are competing responses, and your responses become slower than when you're reading non-color related words or nonsense words. Okay? All right. So that's the end of memory and thinking.